Hello everyone, my name is Andrea Sartorius and I'm a PhD candidate based at the University of Nottingham. My work focuses on a multidisciplinary approach to the impact of trace metal contamination from derelict lead mines in Wales. Trace metals are a class of naturally occurring elements, including lead, cadmium, zinc, copper, arsenic, and mercury. These metals are notable because of their relatively heavy mass and because they are potentially toxic at relatively low concentrations. Exposure to trace metals can impact almost every system in the body and can result in a variety of negative effects from inhibited growth, reduced fertility, shortened lifespan, immunosuppression, and cancer. In 2017, trace metal exposure in humans alone resulted in over 1 million deaths and over 24 million disability-adjusted life years worldwide. However, trace metals are also relatively abundant and malleable, so they have been used by humans throughout history. For example, lead was a key metal in many ancient civilizations, and more recently was extensively used in petrol and paint. Because of the intensive demand for trace metal mining has been occurring for thousands of years. In the UK in particular, metal mining was common from before the Roman invasion. During the Industrial Age, when UK metal mining was at its peak, the UK was the world's primary producer of lead, tin, and copper. However, in the late 1800s to early 1900s, depletion of the mines and competition from abroad led to the industry's collapse. In Wales alone, this has led to over 1,400 abandoned metal mines. After the mines were closed, mine waste was left behind in the form of large spoil heaps. Spoil heaps contain high concentrations of trace metals and are often unstable and situated next to waterways. So wind and water erosion results in high concentrations of trace metals entering and spreading throughout the environment. So coming into this project, we had two primary objectives. First, to determine the distribution of trace metals at sites impacted by historic lead mining activities, and second, to understand the resulting impact on environmental, animal, and human well-being. Now, while this project examines a variety of trace metals, for brevity's sake, I will focus primarily on lead during this talk. Now, we chose to focus our study in Mid Wales, where trace metal contamination is still an ongoing issue. As you can see, the lead topsoil concentrations in that region are notably high. Now, we specifically chose to focus on sampling two derelict mine sites, which I will refer to as Mine A and Mine B for anonymization purposes. Both these mines were previous lead mines. They were both closed about 100 years ago, and they have waterways flowing through them directly past the spoil heaps. In both areas, we visited the mine site, as well as a private property directly downstream of the mine, and a nearby control site. At each site, we collected environmental samples to determine the levels of contamination. We then tracked rodents and collected tissues to determine trace metal loads, and we opportunistically sampled from domestic animals and collected local food products as well. We found large-scale environmental trace metal pollution both at the mine sites and at areas downstream. While the mine sites were barren and very clearly contaminated, we also found high trace metal concentrations in areas that looked pristine and healthy. As you can see here, the soil samples that we collected at the mine sites and the private properties downstream of the mines had lead concentrations that were tens, if not hundreds of times higher than at the control site. The soil lead concentrations also consistently exceeded the Welsh soil normal background concentration, as found by the British Geological Survey. Now, this all indicates that the soil lead concentrations are much higher than you would normally expect to find in this region. We observed similar trends for the sediments, where sediment lead concentrations were again consistently tens to hundreds of times higher than those in the control sites. The sediment concentrations were also above the probable effect level threshold, above which adverse health effects to aquatic organisms living in the waterways are expected. This likely explains why there are no fish in the sampled streams, even though similar nearby streams do contain fish. We next trapped small rodents at the sites to determine if animals living in trace metal contaminated areas were taking up the trace metals into their bodies. We specifically examined kidney, liver, and bone, as trace metals are commonly sequestered in these three tissues. When we examined the lead concentrations in these three tissues, we found statistically significant differences depending on where the animal was collected. As you can see, for all three tissues, the highest lead concentrations were found at the mine sites, followed by slightly lower ones at the private property, and then almost negligible concentrations at the control sites. This clearly indicates that animals living on trace metal contaminated land do take up the trace metals into their bodies. But is this affecting their well-being? Well, we are currently working on addressing that in rodents, but we do have some evidence of negative impacts in domestic animals. First of all, a landowner living about 4 kilometers downstream of Mine A asked us to investigate 2 of their Indian runner ducks that had died of unknown causes. Now, upon post-mortem examination, we found that the ducks' tissue lead concentrations consistently greatly exceeded the threshold for severe clinical lead poisoning in birds. We also found liver tissue degradation and possible lead inclusion bodies, which are all indicative of lead toxicity. This all has led us to believe that these birds were adversely affected by their lead exposure. To investigate the effects on domestic animals further, we examined live animals living on a farm about 1 kilometer downstream of Mine B. We collected blood samples, which indicate lead exposure over a few weeks. All but the cat had elevated blood lead concentrations above 30 micrograms per liter, but only the chickens had a mean blood lead concentration indicating toxicity. It's important to note that one of the horses at this property had laryngeal hemiplegia, a disease which affects the upper airway. Even though this disease has been linked with lead exposure in the past, at the time of sampling, the horse's blood lead concentration was below the lead toxicity threshold. However, the horse's laryngeal hemiplegia continued to worsen over time, and eventually its quality of life became so bad that, unfortunately, it had to be put down. Afterwards, we examined the horse's liver and kidney and found lead concentrations that were elevated above the lead toxicity threshold in horses. It's therefore extremely important to remember that blood lead concentrations only provide a snapshot of current exposure and can fail to indicate chronic lead exposure, even in very serious cases. Now, as I noted before, the chicken blood lead concentrations were also notably high. Upon further examination, we believe that the high blood lead concentrations are due to the chickens taking up mine spoil from a nearby track as grit, therefore constantly exposing themselves to high lead concentration. The chickens' high blood lead concentrations made us curious about the possible lead concentration in the chickens' eggs. In particular, since the eggs were being produced for human consumption, we wondered whether they contained enough lead to pose a risk to humans. Upon examination of eggs from farms near the mine sites, we found high lead concentrations. Based on the European Food Safety Authority regulation on the max amount of eggs a human can consume per day before experiencing negative health effects, you could only eat around 2 of the eggs per day from either mine site. For comparison, you could eat well over 100 eggs from the supermarket before reaching this threshold. The duck eggs in Mine A, laid by ducks living in similar conditions to the ones we discussed earlier, had even higher lead concentrations, so eating even 1 would push you far over this lead intake threshold. After examining the eggs, we became curious if other food products produced downstream of the mine were also contaminated with lead. So we collected various vegetables from the gardens of private properties downstream of the mine sites. We found varying lead concentrations across the many different vegetables we sampled. However, of particular note, we found high lead concentrations in the marrow, rhubarb, and potatoes. Even after watching these vegetables, you can only eat in a day just over 1/2 a marrow, less than 2 rhubarb stems, and 5 very small potatoes before exceeding the IFSA lead daily intake threshold. However, it's also extremely important to note that many health organizations, including the World Health Organization, say that there is no level of exposure to lead that is known to be without harmful effects. Therefore, even eating 1 or 2 of those eggs or a couple potatoes a day is not a guarantee of safety when it comes to lead toxicity. To summarize, the key findings of this project are that there are high concentrations of trace metals both at and downstream of these mine sites, that trace metals are also present in high concentrations in wildlife, domestic animals, and domestic animal products, and that there are indications that high trace metal concentrations are negatively affecting the well-being of animal and human residents. This project is still ongoing, and the next big step is to investigate whether resident rodents are being impacted by their high trace metal loads. We will compare things like viral load, gut microbiome community, and immune function across rodents from contaminated and control sites to assess the potential impacts of trace metal exposure. We're also working on informing the public about the extent and possible effects of trace metal contamination. I would like to thank my supervisors, the undergraduate students who helped me in the field, the private landowners, my funders, the Envision Doctoral Training Partnership, and the University of Nottingham for their help and funding during this project. Thank you very much for listening to my talk. Please feel free to ask any questions or email or message me on Twitter after the presentation. And if you're interested and want to learn more, I've included a QR code that links to a short animation explaining my research and its implications. Thank you again.